Welcome to Maysville this morning. Good to see everyone out. We had our child promotion and classes this morning. Hope we all had a good class with our Bible study. About to begin our worship hour. If you're visiting this morning, we're glad to have you with us. And if you don't mind filling out one of the visitor's cards on the backs of the pew in front of you, we'd like to have a record of your attendance. And if you can, pass those towards the center aisles. Ushers will come back down in just a few moments and collect those. Opening song this morning, number 510, number 510. Hope you had a chance to grab a bulletin on your way in. We've got several upcoming events and notes there. Don't forget, tonight will be our family game night after services this evening. You're asked to bring finger foods and a favorite board game. And this is open to all here of our congregation, so make plans to be a part of that tonight. Don't forget as well, ladies' night out will be Tuesday at 6 p.m. at the home of Holly Lewis, and asked to bring finger foods, drinks and desserts, and a lawn chair. And also, Secret Pals will have the reveal party next Sunday night after services at the home of Rachel Bowen. And if you have any questions on that, you can see Johnya Hawkins, and you are asked to bring finger foods and a $15 gift for your current Secret Pal. Please make note, we've got our community outreach coming up in December, and we'll have weekly food items that need to be brought in every week. This week is 16-ounce canned ham, and if you could make sure to pay attention to those notes and try to bring those every single week. We're taking up our collection coming up here for December, and be greatly appreciated. And we've got several that have been kind of hit and miss here recently. Well, please remember Tom Horn. I know I saw Phillips here this morning, Dolly Gargis, Gordon Hicks is here, and Lois Webster. We've got several that are with us that have not been recently, and it's good to see everyone here. But please make sure we continue to pray for those that are not here and need our support and our encouragement. There'll be no elders and deacons meeting today, but that'll be postponed to next Sunday. So no elders and deacons meeting today. I think it's all the announcements we have this morning. Again, opening song number 510. Closing prayer this morning will be by Brian Norris. We will have pew packers this afternoon at 4:45 p.m. before our evening worship. Let's all begin our worship this morning, and Charles Collins lead us in our opening prayer.
Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we are thankful for the blessings of life, the opportunity that we have in front of us this morning to come to you in prayer. Father, thank you for a good, safe night that's allowed us to come to you this morning. Father, thank you for this Labor Day weekend that we have. Father, we thank you for our jobs. And Father, we thank you for just watching over us every day and always providing for us every day. Father, we pray for those that are traveling, that are not with us today, that they'll be back with us soon. Father, we thank you for this beautiful weather that we're having. A touch of fall that's in the air, the things that are forthcoming that freshens us, that freshens the earth. Father, we thank you for life itself. We thank you for being patient with us, loving us, and always caring for us, and listening to us, and answering our prayers. Father, there are several that are mentioned this morning that have been sick, that are back with us today, and we thank you for their attendance, their willingness to come. We know that they still continue to struggle with health issues. Pray that you continue to watch over them. Continue to be with Tom and Sandra, and that they'll be back with us soon too. And Father, we thank you for our health. Father, we thank you for those that are protecting us right now, both here and abroad, that allows us to be able to come together. We pray for their safety and their well-being, and pray that they'll be back with us soon. Father, we pray for our missionaries, the work that's going on. We pray for their safety. We pray that you continue to watch over them, and that our congregation will continue to provide support where we can. And Father, we just thank you for loving us every day. Pray that you'll go with us now, and we'll focus on your word and our song service, partaking of the Lord's Supper. And Father, forgive us of our sins. For in Jesus Christ we pray. Amen.
Oh, good. Number 193, actually. I think the booth got 194, but sort of same title, but one we know better. 193.
We'll do the first
and the third stanza of this, please.
Guide me, O thou great Jehovah, pilgrim through this barren land. I am weak, but thou art mighty. Hold me with thy powerful hand. Bread of heaven, feed me till I want no more.
Two hundred twenty-six. This morning we observe our Lord's Supper, not lightly and not without regard to the great price that was paid for our salvation. We acknowledge the pre-planning of God and His wisdom, knowing that we were going to need a Savior, and that Savior would be His Son, Jesus Christ, who came and gave of Himself. And we're going to sing the first and third stanza of this, but we acknowledge God's greatness and His wisdom to provide a plan for our salvation, to bring a Savior that will live a perfect life and give Himself fully at the cross and purchase our salvation there, not just because of His death, but because of His resurrection. We know then, as we look at this, we can only stand in awe this morning as we recognize God is the administrator of this great sacrifice and price paid. First and third stanzas before we partake of His emblems this morning.
O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see my soul, my Savior God.
Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning thanking you for everything that you've given us in our lives. God, we thank you for Jesus, who came, died on the cross for us, who suffered for us. This great gift, Father, we ask that as we take this bread this morning, that we'll do it in a manner well-pleasing to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Would you bow with me? Father, we're so thankful for this cup and all that it represents, that fruit of the vine that represents the blood of Christ that cleanses us, that reconciles us back to you. Father, help us to partake of this cup in a manner that pleases you. Help us to look back to the cross. In Jesus' name, amen.
Number 24, we'll sing the first and last stanzas before we have opportunity to give back to God this morning of our possessions. We recognize God in this song as the creator of all things, and Him being all-powerful, and the one that we give our divine homage to, because without Him nothing would be in existence. The Bible tells us He created all things, and He's going to destroy it all one day and get rid of it. So it's a time capsule that we're in, if you will. As long as you live and we live, we have opportunity to use those things that God has created to His glory. And giving back to Him today is one way we can glorify Him. First and third stanzas.
Father in heaven, we are grateful for all the blessings in our life. You have blessed us far beyond our needs, far more than we need to sustain our lives. We take this opportunity now to give back a portion of what we have, and thank you for giving us an opportunity to give our offering to our church this morning. We pray your blessing on this offering and on us as we continue our work here. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Like to mark number 739. 739, we'll use that as a song after our lesson this morning. And now number 755, we'll do the first and the last stanzas of this. If you'd like to, please stand, we'll sing it together.
When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal bright and fair, when
Good morning. It's good to see each of you this morning. Glad that you're here. It is a beautiful holiday weekend for us to enjoy, and we are thankful that you are here to enjoy it with us. Some of you are visiting from out of town or other places, and we're glad that you're a part of our service this morning. I know that sooner or later, I am going to have a lesson prepared to use on this mechanical device or electronics, and it's going to fail. I thought this morning might be it, but it looks like it's going to come to life after all, and I'm thankful for that. We are glad that you're here. It is a blessing on the Lord's Day to be able to gather and worship. There have been several in our midst who have not been with us for some time, and we're glad that they're able to be out and about, and good to have them back. There is one family that we are still missing desperately, and that's Tom and Sandra Horn, who have not been with us since the first week in February. And we certainly hope that it won't be long before they are also back in our midst. And Tom and Sandra, if you are watching today, we are thinking about you. I heard a story about a young man, 10, 12 years old, who was visiting with his grandmother. And somehow the subject of bald eagles came up. And he said, "Well, you know, Grandma, bald eagles are not really bald. They really have white feathers on their head, and it only looks like they're bald from a distance." And the grandmother said, "Boy, what's wrong with you? They're called bald eagles. They're bald." And he said, "No, Grandma, they're really not bald." Well, back in the day, there were encyclopedias in the house. Now, some of you may not know what encyclopedias are. They're books that you look things up in, sort of like the old internet. So he went and found the encyclopedia and looked up the article under bald eagles. And it began, "Bald eagles, one of America's great birds of prey, are not really bald. Rather, they are covered with white feathers, and from a distance, they only look bald." He said, "See, Grandma, they're not really bald at all." And she says, "Boy, put that book up, or you're not going to get anything to eat." Why is it that we don't take correction well? Receiving correction is a hard thing to do. It's hard for anyone to do. Why? Well, part of the reason may be because we want to believe that we're always right. And isn't that the way all of us are? What is it that you believe that's wrong? What facts do you hold to that aren't facts at all, that they're untrue? Well, obviously, if you knew what you believe that may not be true, you wouldn't believe it anymore. You would hold to those things that are true. So all of the things we hold to, we believe to be true. So that creates part of the problem. A second problem is we tend to be competitive. And if I'm wrong, that often means that someone else, often in a case of argumentation, must be right. And we are often unwilling to admit that someone else knows more, that they know better, that they are superior in knowledge or in any other way. And so we're just not willing to accept that. Or it might be that we blame others for whatever it is that's involved, that someone else is responsible. We might say, for example, "I'm not a sinner. The Bible's just unfair. I don't want to believe any of these things." And there are wonderful examples, both in the Old Testament and the New, of people who found themselves in a place of needing correction. But if we stop for a moment and spend some time with the Scriptures, we will find that we must embrace the idea that we all have things to learn. And we all, from time to time, find ourselves making mistakes. I have a long and painful list of things that I have done that were mistakes. Now, I don't parade that list out in front of you, and I don't go over it very often, perhaps in my own mind, but trust me, it's there. It's much more enjoyable for me to demonstrate or to talk about those areas of my success than those areas of my failure. But to be completely honest, when we begin to look at our own lives and we see those areas in which we failed, those are also the areas in which we grew. And we recognize that we needed a correction in our lives. The bad news is my list is probably not finished. Proverbs chapter 3 verse 12 says, "Whom the Lord loves, he corrects, just as a father the son in whom he delights." When the scriptures tell us about God correcting us, and the correction can come in a variety of forms, it's not because God does not love us, but rather because God does love us. The connection that is made in the relationship is as a father. All of us who are parents understand that we discipline our children, we instruct them and correct them because we care about their well-being. It's not because you don't care for them, but rather because you do care for them, that you want to for them to do what's right and for them to live in the right way. People who love me want me to do what's right. And people who really love me will tell me when I'm doing something wrong. Now, it may not be easy to hear, and I probably don't want to hear it, but if I'm smart, I will listen. In fact, in Revelation chapter 3 and verse 19, Jesus said, "As many as I love, I chasten." But what are the alternatives to accepting correction? And it may be that instead of correction, we want to do something else. There's an interesting translation in Proverbs chapter 12, verse 1. Now, I'm reading from the New King James Version. Is the reason I put the New King James Version there so that you would recognize it. Because the last word in this sentence has become one of those words that we don't use in polite company anymore. You're not supposed to say these things. And so in order to honor the request of probably a lot of parents in here, I'm not going to read that last word. You can read it for yourself. "The he who hates correction is, well, they're foolish. They are not smart." The word that is translated there by the New King James Version actually means to behave like a cow. Now, have you ever dealt with a cow? Probably some of you have dealt with a cow in some way. You've had to take care of them in some way, give them medication, provide for their well-being, get them penned up, or do something with them. Cows are not intelligent creatures. Sometimes they will do things that hurt themselves. They are foolish, and the person who hates correction, the writer of Proverbs said, is like a cow. They're brutes. Proverbs chapter 13, verse 18 says, "Poverty and shame comes to him who disdains correction." Not only are they not intelligent if you disdain or don't want correction, but also it's going to affect your outcome. The writer of Proverbs describes that the concept of those who will not receive correction is that your financial well-being will suffer because of it, and you will find yourself embarrassed. "It is a fool who despises his father's correction or instruction, but he who receives correction is wise." My guess is this morning that our audience is made up of a number of people, both men and women, who grew up while they were young and at home believing that their parents didn't know what they were talking about. And you disregarded what they thought, and you didn't want to hear what they said, and you didn't want to do what they told you to do. But as you grew up in life, you came to understand that your parents knew what they were talking about and that they were interested in your own well-being. The person who receives correction is wise. Now, I'm going to talk about this morning three models of how people might receive correction. You ready? Number one, you've got the armadillo response. Armadillo. You know what armadillos do when they are confronted with something? Well, they roll up in a ball. This is what they call a three-band armadillo, which I'm told from research is the only ones who can actually roll up into the complete tight little ball that we have here. The word armadillo is Spanish. You know what it means? Little armored one. Well, this little armored one, when something happens around him, he just rolls up into a ball. And it is the only mammal that has these shields built around. And it can just roll up in a ball, and it doesn't matter what happens. You know, some people are like armadillos. When someone tries to deal with them in some way, they just clam up. They're not going to hear it. When someone has a criticism to offer or suggestion to make, they're not going to hear it. Nothing is ever their fault. It's always somebody else's fault. They are never wrong. They don't need to listen to anybody. They don't need to change their life in any way. They just ignore everything that goes on around them. I know there's no armadillos in here. Let's look at a couple of examples. We're going to use many of our examples this morning from the book of Jeremiah. And let's start in Jeremiah chapter 37. First couple of verses. Now King Zedekiah, Jeremiah 37:1, the son of Josiah reigned instead of Coniah, the son of Jeconiah, whom Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, made king in the land of Judah. Now that's a lot of names in there, but let's jump over the name list and start over again. King Zedekiah reigned, verse 2, but neither he nor his servants nor the people of the land gave heed to the words of the Lord, which he spoke by the prophet Jeremiah. You know how they responded? Just like an armadillo. They just rolled up and they didn't want to hear it. They just tuned Jeremiah out, and they didn't want anything to do with what he said. Sometimes in the area of sports, folks talk about a player who is uncoachable. Sometimes that discussion comes up in conversation regarding executives or people who are coming up in a company or a management. They're being groomed for some place, but they are uncoachable. And you know what that means? It means they won't listen. It means they won't follow instruction. They won't look at their own selves and see what's going on with them. If there's anything wrong, they won't own up to it. It's always someone else's fault. They won't take action to do the kinds of things that they ought to do to make themselves better. They won't improve. They always have a reason why. Why it's not their fault, why they shouldn't change, why they shouldn't do whatever it is that somebody else wants them to do. There's always someone to blame. I'm sure it's not you, but there are a lot of people like Zedekiah. But if you think Zedekiah is bad, drop back a chapter. Here's another king, he was worse. In the fourth year, Jeremiah 36:1, it came to pass in the fourth year of Jehoiakim, the son of Josiah, king of Judah, that the word came to Jeremiah from the Lord, saying, take a scroll of a book and write on it all the words that I have spoken to you against Israel, against Judah, and against all the nations from the day I spoke to you, from the days of Josiah even to this day. It may be that the house of Judah will hear all the adversities which I purpose to bring upon them, that everyone may turn from his evil way, that I may forgive their iniquity and their sin. Then Jeremiah called Baruch the son of Neriah, and Baruch wrote on a scroll of the book at the instruction of Jeremiah all the words of the Lord which he had spoken to him. All right, so God says to Jeremiah, you write this letter to a king, and the king may listen. And so Jeremiah gets the letter written, and it gets sent out. We'll drop down a little bit in our reading so we don't get caught up in all the discussion here. Drop down to verse 21. So the king sent Jehudi to bring the scroll, and he took it from Elishama, the scribe's chamber. And Jehudi read it in the hearing of the king and in the hearing of all the princes who stood beside the king. Now the king was sitting in the winter house in the ninth month with a fire burning on the hearth before him. And it happened as Jehudi had read three or four columns that the king cut it with the scribe's knife and cast it onto the fire that was on the hearth, until all the scroll was consumed in the fire that was on the hearth. Yet they were not afraid, nor did they tear their garments, the king nor any of his servants who heard all these words. Now God's told Jeremiah to write this book, a letter to the king, so that the king can repent. And you know what the king does when he hears the words? He takes a knife out, and he cuts it up in pieces, and he burns it in the fire. Some people are like armadillos. They're not going to listen. They're not going to pay you any attention. They're going to hear the word of the Lord, and it's going to have no effect on them whatsoever. They're going to hear instruction or correction, and it's going to have no impact on them whatsoever. They are never going to think, does this actually apply to me? Second response, porcupine. I don't know if you've ever been around a porcupine. I suspect every little kid has imagined that the porcupine is one of the coolest animals around. You probably imagined that, you know, the porcupine ought to be able to shoot those quills. It's like, you know, the ultimate dart gun. Actually, porcupines can't shoot their quills, but when something touches them, they can stick it in them, and then it turns loose, and then you're stuck. The word porcupine is actually from the Latin word, which means quill pig. Interesting term. If you ever round a porcupine, when provoked, porcupines are untouchable. Now, you can beat all over an armadillo, and all it's going to do is just lay there in a ball. You start whacking on a porcupine, and it's going to fight back. Hard. And some people are like that. Some people might ignore you when you try to correct them, but other people, they get mad. They fight back. They blow up. They come apart, and you may not like what happens when they do. Now, somewhere under all those quills is a dog. If you do try to correct a porcupine, guess what? You're going to get it. They are going to try to inflict pain on you, and everything escalates. Whatever problem it is, it's going to be your problem. And it may get to such a point that nobody wants anything to do with a porcupine at all. And there are examples of that in Scripture. For example, let's go to Jeremiah chapter 19. And if you thought Zedekiah was something, or if you thought our second king was something, in Jeremiah chapter 19, we're going to find another guy by the name of Pashur. And Pashur has a different response altogether than just ignoring someone who's causing him discomfort or speaking things that he doesn't want to hear. Pashur is willing to fight back. Jeremiah 19, let's start reading in verse 14. Then Jeremiah came from Tophet, where the Lord had sent him to prophesy, and he stood in the court of the Lord's house and said to all the people, "Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, behold, I will bring on this city and on all their towns all the doom that I have pronounced against it, because they have stiffened their necks that they might not hear my words." Chapter 20, verse 1. Now Pashur, the son of Immer, the priest, who was also chief governor in the house of the Lord, heard that Jeremiah prophesied these things. Then Pashur struck Jeremiah the prophet and put him in the stocks that were in the high gate of Benjamin, which was by the house of the Lord. You see, it wasn't enough for Pashur to just hear things he didn't like. He decided to take action. He decided to have Jeremiah beaten and put in stocks. And so, that's where Jeremiah ends up. You're probably much more familiar with what takes place in the book of Acts, chapter 7. In Acts chapter 7, we are told about Stephen and the events that happened following Stephen's preaching to the Sanhedrin. Stephen is talking to the Jews, and he is preaching regarding Jesus of Nazareth. And what happens as he is preaching? Oh, the people are listening. They're listening all right. They're not like armadillos. Oh, no. They're more like porcupines. Chapter 7, verse 54. I've skipped all the way past Stephen's discussion and getting now to where they respond. When they heard these things, they were cut to the heart, and they gnashed at him with their teeth. But he, being full of the Holy Spirit, gazed into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God, and said, "Look, I see the heavens open and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God." Then they cried out with a loud voice, stopped their ears, and ran at him with one accord. And they cast him out of the city and stoned him. Verse 59 says, they stoned Stephen as he was calling on God, and they took his life. There are some folks, when you try to correct them, their response is to attack. And they want to shut the person down who is providing the correction or the instruction or the information. They're not willing to just not listen. They respond much harsher. But then there's a third response that I want to talk about. And it is the puppy response. My guess is that in a group of this size, we've had some puppy owners. How many of you raised armadillos? Anyone in here? None? How about porcupines? Any porcupine fans in here? No porcupines. How about puppies? Anybody ever have a puppy? Oh, okay. Got some hands on that one. Why did you keep a puppy? Why did you get a puppy? You know puppies turn into dogs, right? Not very many people are interested in a dog. They're interested, though, in puppies. And the reason why is because they're just so lovable. They're cute and okay, yeah, they chew things up. Yes, and they have to be trained, and they mess some things up, but they're so eager to please, and they want to do good, and they want you to be happy with them. You know, if you leave something out, let's say your morning newspaper gets left on the floor, and your puppy finds it. You know what the puppy's going to do to your morning newspaper? Well, yeah, it's going to end up in shreds. He'll have a good old time with that newspaper and rip it all to pieces. And you could come in and take a piece of that paper and roll it up and swat that dog on the backside, and he'll go yelping off with his tail between his legs. But you know what it's going to be like in about 5 minutes, 10 at the most? That puppy's going to be right back there by your side, and his eyes are going to be bright and shiny, and his tail's going to be wagging. He's going to be your best friends again. It's over. It's done. He figured out that wasn't a good idea, and whatever correction process that's been involved with it, that's been taken care of, and now we're best friends again. That's the way puppies are. The person who understands that they needed the correction, that they were wrong, and now we're okay, and things are back to normal. Well, we got some examples of that too. We're already in the book of Acts. Let's go back a couple of chapters past chapter 7. Go back to chapter 2. Now, I'd love to read, starting at verse 22, all of Peter's speech and sermon here as he starts talking about Jesus of Nazareth and developing all the folks and all of the things that he did. But I'm not going to do that. I'm going to skip past all of that. Drop down to verse 36. Therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ. Don't miss for a minute that Peter has laid this right at their feet. He hadn't said they did it, someone else did it, there's someone that we could imagine who did it. He said, you did it. It's your fault. You're responsible. You did this. This person that God has planned to bring into the world to save mankind, you took and killed. Now, how do they respond to that? Look at the first part of verse 37. Now, when they heard this, they were cut to the heart. Huh. Go back a couple of pages to the beginning, this beginning of verse 54 of chapter 7. And what did it say? When they heard these things, they were cut to the heart. Well, how about exactly the same words? How about that? When Stephen preached and the Jews on Pentecost, or Jews there in the that temple, heard that preaching, you know how they responded? They heard those things and they were cut to the heart. Now on the day of Pentecost, Peter's preaching, and this group says, it says concerning them, when they heard these things, they were cut to the heart. Same response up to this point. The Jews in Acts chapter 7 attacked Stephen, drug him outside, and stoned him to death. But these are not porcupine Jews in Acts chapter 2. These are puppy Jews. And you know how they respond? When they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and to the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? They recognized they were wrong. And they wanted to be right. And they said, what do we need to do about this? They didn't deny it. They didn't try to escape it. They accepted it as fact, but wanted to make their lives right. Let's go back and read from Psalm chapter 32. Psalm 32, starting at verse 1. I'm not sure we'll do all of it. It only has 11 verses. Blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man to whom the Lord does not impute iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit. When I kept silent, my bones grew old through my groaning all the day long. For day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My vitality was turned into the drought of summer. I acknowledged my sin to you, and my iniquity I have not hidden. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the iniquity of my sin. For this cause, everyone who is godly shall pray to you in a time when you may be found. Surely in a flood of great waters they shall not come near him. You are my hiding place. You shall preserve me from trouble. You shall surround me with songs of deliverance. We could go on to the end. This Psalm of David. David said, when I didn't acknowledge that I was wrong, I felt this weight of God upon me. But as soon as I confessed my sin, he said, then God has provided for me again. There are times when we will be wrong in life. What are you going to do about it? 1 John chapter 1, verse 9, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. You know what that requires? It requires a person who acknowledges that they're wrong and that they want to make it right. No matter what age we are, no matter what gender, no matter what occupation we may have, there is one life skill that you need. It would save a world of marriages if people could take these three little steps. I was wrong. I am sorry. I will change. You see, that's the kind of response that recognizes that something is wrong in life and it's my fault. Nothing can be fixed. If we're wrong and we want to deny it, we roll up into a ball like a porcupine. That's not my fault. Or we roll into a ball like an armadillo and say it's not my fault. Or we respond like a porcupine and try to attack the person who's telling us and fight them. Oh, it's your fault. Or it's somebody else's fault. Then we're left in the same place we always were. Messed up. Unwilling to receive correction. But the person who will receive correction is the one who makes their life right. So I've got a question for you. How do you respond when you're corrected? How do you respond when the instruction of God or the instruction of others or the correction of whomever may be responsible for helping you in life? And it may come from a variety of different sources depending on what your age is, what your relationship in life is to other people. But there are things that come up. God's Word is always correcting us if we will read the instruction of the Word of God, and it will help us to live our lives better. So what are you going to do? Ignore it? Are you going to attack the person who brought the information to you? Or are you going to say, yeah, that's me. I was wrong. I'm sorry. I'll change. This morning, it is certain that all of us will find ourselves in a place where we need correction. What remains to be seen is how you'll respond to it. Some people will turn a deaf ear. Some will attack. Some will respond. They'll change. They'll be made right. What's your response to the Word of God as it corrects you? What is your response to the gospel of Jesus Christ that comes to us and tells us about a Savior who came into the world to save us from our sins? The instructions of God that tell us how to change our lives and marshal ourselves so that we can be right with God, to repent, to make our lives right. It may be this morning that you need to respond today. That your response to God up until this point has been to not hear, or perhaps your response has been to fight back. Instead, come to God and become the friend of God like Abraham was. Become the friend of God like David was, the one who listened to instruction and changed his life. It may be that you need to respond this morning. The invitation of Christ is extended to you. If this morning you need to change your life in a public way, it may be that you need to confess your faith in Jesus Christ this morning and be baptized for the remission of sins. It may be that you need to come home and come back to God. If you need to respond in a public way, come as we stand and sing.
Closing song in a moment will be 449. 449 will do the first and last stanzas. We thank you for visiting, if that's the case, this morning. Hope you'll come back even tonight at 5 o'clock. We'll worship at that time also, or let us know if you have other needs we can assist you with. I had one announcement passed to me that didn't meet earlier timetable. Pre-planning always is involved in the Honduras trip, so they mentioned there'll be a meeting next Sunday morning. If you have some interest in maybe going on that trip next year in July, you might want to attend that meeting next Sunday morning. These two stanzas, and then we'll be led in our closing prayer.
Oh, the bitter pain and sorrow of a time committing, when I proudly said to Jesus, all of self and none of thee, all of self and none of thee, all of self and none of thee, when I
Father God, so humbling to come before you, that you, eternal, all-powerful, and all-knowing, turn your ears to our concerns and our fears that are small and time short, and just thank you for listening to us, hearing our prayers. Father, we're thankful for your plan. You would care for us so much that you'd give that great gift, and that your Son would come and take what we deserve. Father, let us listen to your correction when you give it to us, and turn to you when we're turning away. Father, thank you for this group of your people. Father, help us to carry each other along towards you, to be strong for each other when we have weakness among us. Father, as we go out into this week, into the world, help us to draw more people to you with our words and our actions, that they may know you as well. In your Son's holy name we pray. Amen.
Hey, Brian, how you doing? Good. How are you?